Grenadine, the Kudzu Queen, by Wiley Cash. Read by Elisa Harris. 1942 was my year. I reckon you've heard a lot of people say things like that, but I really mean it. I was the Kudzu Queen. Of course, they call me that now, but it's for a different reason. To look back on your life can be a strange thing, and sometimes I find myself wondering if it all happened to somebody else. After all, who would have ever thought that me, Grenadine Purdy, would be the Kudzu Queen of Ennery, South Carolina? When I was a little girl, there were festivals and parades every year on July 4th. But on this particular year, things just felt different. People seemed more excited. Maybe it was because the summer had come again, and we knew that a lot of our boys would be leaving us soon, but they were with us then. Maybe it was the summer heat, or maybe it was something else I can't quite put a finger to, but sometimes I think it could have been the plant. No one had ever seen it or even heard anything about it until he came. It's funny. Now you can't drive a mile in the South without seeing it everywhere. It just grows so fast. The writer, James Dickey, the man who wrote that movie about the friends getting lost on the river, well, he wrote a poem called Kudzu. He wrote, "You must close your windows at night to keep it out of the house." And let me tell you, he's right. Now, I've never met Mr. James Dickey, and I don't really know what he thought about Kudzu besides the quote that I got embroidered and framed over my mantle. But I did meet him. And I guess that's where this whole story starts. 1942 was oven hot. The upstate gets hot every summer, don't get me wrong, but this was something different. You could walk outside and your back would feel like somebody'd hung a wet cloth over it. Plain miserable. I'd just graduated from high school. I'd been a cheerleader. The Woodruff Wolverines, state football champs. Anyway, the Dust Bowl problem out west was just beginning to settle down, and the rest of the country was finally learning about that evil called erosion. But of course, we didn't know we should be scared until he came. But other people knew. They picked up his radio show out of Atlanta. Yes, he even broadcasted a radio show about Kudzu right from his front porch on WSBAM. He was a prophet if there ever was one. His name was Channing Cope, and he made me the Kudzu Queen. Now, I said people still call me the Kudzu Queen, and it's true. Now I make things with the plant, baskets, paper, things like that, and I can tell you this, they sell. People are always hearing about me and taking our exit off I-26 to see if I've got anything new. I make things with the leaves, too, jelly, syrup, deep-fried kudzu leaves. You can wrinkle your nose, but I bet you'd like it if you tried. My husband Jerry used to think I was insane, but after 49 years of marriage, I guess he's given up on me ever changing. Oh, he's retired. He used to be a school principal in Spartanburg, South Carolina. That's where we live. But our daughters haven't always taken it as easily as Jerry. They hated riding the school bus and walking down the aisle toward an empty seat while all those little faces were turned and looking out the windows, watching as Dinah and June's mother wrestled down a kudzu vine in the backyard. I'd spread it out in the yard, twist it, weave it, and have a couple of baskets by the time they got home. And that afternoon, there'd be those little faces again, watching Dinah and June walk past the same crazy mother and into the house. It stopped bothering them eventually, but sometimes they still got upset. The worst fit they ever pitched was in high school, when I put the painted sign in front of the house. Baskets by Grenadine, the Kudzu Queen. They called it tacky. I called it business. Well, Channing Cope came to Ennery and talked to the mayor, Jesse Winkler, and told him about the problems and terrors of erosion. He showed him the kudzu plant and explained how it can stop soil from eroding, and that news just about drove people wild. At Cope's suggestion, they decided right then and there to incorporate a kudzu festival with the 4th of July. That day, the first annual Ennery 4th of July Kudzu Festival was born. Everybody knows that a holiday needs a parade. And what in the world would Thanksgiving be without Macy's, right? Lucky for me, the city's council had the foresight to know that a Kudzu Queen should lead a parade like the one they had in mind, and they decided to hold an audition. Now, I'd already tried to be Homecoming Queen, but I got beat by Betsy Bloomfield. I don't know how. I always guessed the judging was based on promiscuity because I was a damn sight prettier than her. Everybody told me that. My mother talked me into auditioning for the parade. She said she thought I could win. I think it was really because she knew the Bloomfields were on vacation up in Lake Lore, so there was no chance of me getting whipped by Betsy again. For whatever reason, I tried out. Let me tell you about nervous. That was me. I dressed up in my cheerleading sweater, and I did a baton routine while singing the Lord's Prayer. I wanted them to know I had good vocal and motor skills, just in case they expected me to deliver a speech while waving or something like that. I don't know why I sang the Lord's Prayer. It wasn't like we were church people. We went during the summer because my daddy had his barbershop closed on Sundays, but we never heard anything good. Reverend Sumi was too old to save anybody's soul. All we ever heard him talk about was the sin of daylight savings. He would slam his fist down and demand that we get back on God's time. When I was a little girl, I'd always doze off against my daddy's arm during church while wondering what God's watch looked like. As you can probably guess, I brought the house down. I sang the Lord's Prayer like it was meant to be sung. Sexy. I twirled that baton and pushed out my breasts like nobody's business, and everybody watching stood up and clapped when I finished. Channing Cope walked up to me right then and there and told me he'd found the Kudzu Queen. Some boys in the back working the spotlight started cheering, and I think one of them might have been Natty Pitts. Back then, I never really wanted anything I didn't already have. I never really was passionate about anything. Maybe that's why I always took Natty Pitts with a grain of salt. All through school, he was always writing me love letters and trying to walk me home. You know, the kinds of things boys did back then for girls they liked. I never really thought about him being attractive. But I was never the Kudzu Queen before then, either. July 4th rolled around slow as Christmas. My mother dressed me in a long white dress and pulled my brown hair tight around my head. She curled my ponytail into little ringlets, and I felt beautiful. They drove me in the back of a shiny black convertible Ford. At the end, I climbed up on a little rickety stage and gave a speech about the importance of our country's independence and how'd we stand up to any dictator who came our way. Channing Cope wrote something for me to say about kudzu, but he didn't hear it. He was long gone to some other town, exciting some other mayor and honoring some other kudzu queen. He was a guru, a true pioneer, if you ask me. When the U.S. stopped advocating kudzu growth in the 50s, I bet he about lost his mind. And in 1972, when the USDA declared it a weed, well, I figured Mr. Cope probably just up and killed himself. Now I know what being watched feels like. That night, I was watched. It seemed like every boy in town was there to see the parade, and there I was up on stage in my dress, sweating like you wouldn't believe. And when I stood to give my speech, those little beads of sweat on my chest ran down into my dress and burned me like fire. I knew he was watching. Right after I walked off the stage, he was there. Something was different. Maybe it was the heat, the smell of the fireworks somewhere out in the dark, or maybe it was his eyes and the burning in my dress. I've been married for 49 years, and I've burned for Jerry a million times. That man has given me more pleasure than any one woman could ever deserve. But I've never wanted anything like I wanted Natty Pitts that night. We ended up walking around the street during the festival, me still in my dress and him in slacks and a blue shirt, rings of sweat around his armpits, his blonde hair shaved close and sharp. We made our way to the park, away from the crowds and the noise, away from the 4th of July and all the people we knew. We kissed, and he leaned into me with a force I never imagined and still can't quite put my finger on. When it was over, I went home, my white dress dusty and wrinkled, my lips smiling and wet. They say lovers can't sleep with a heavy heart, but I can tell you that's not true. That night, I slept like a child's dream and woke the next morning as the Kudzu Queen. My daughters are grown and married. One lives in Houston and the other in Asheville. I love them dearly, and we tried to raise them right. But even now, I long for another child, as if something inside me tells me it's not complete, that my story was never finished or a new one never begun. That's how I know. Natty Pitts came around a lot the next few weeks, and I know he was hoping for something that would never happen again. I felt guilty that I'd given in to him that one night. Not that I was a pillar of morality, but I just didn't want to hurt him any more than he had had to be hurt. One afternoon, we were sitting out on his parents' front porch. The swing beneath us creaked while we swayed back and forth. Kudzu grew from the side of his house and ran up a tree, disappearing into the leaves. It had already started. Natty reached for my hand, but I pulled it away and looked at him. I had to tell him I was sorry for what happened, that I knew I could never be with him, not the way he wanted. His eyes kind of welled up, but he fought back the tears, which was just about broke my heart. He told me the least I could do was let him watch me walk away. So that's what I did. I got up, walked down the stairs, into the yard, never looking back. I never saw him again, and he never knew. A few days later, he signed up to fight in the war. I never really heard any news of him, just that he died somewhere in Europe during a battle. Even now, I imagine him dead on a beach, still 18 years old, ocean washing up around him, his face and body perfect and new, while the dead scattered around him are bloody and broken. I didn't get my period that first month. I knew. My friend Jeanette said not to worry because it happened to her all the time, but that didn't make any difference about how I felt. I sat on the steps watching cars go by that summer, Kudzu growing all over Innery, while I felt a small child tug at cords in my body, growing, becoming real. The next month was different, though. I didn't get my period, but something else happened. I made myself believe that it was a mishap in my cycle, that I skipped a month, but something told me that that wasn't true. I bled out the little life that had been growing inside me, and its father was dead on a beach somewhere where people didn't even speak English. But all this happened years ago, in a time I can't hardly remember, to a girl I can't quite picture. And I suppose it all turned out fine. I'm happy, and even now I can look out into the backyard and see the kudzu vine still growing, weaving, trying to complete the circle. But at night, I close my windows. Wiley Cash is the New York Times bestselling author of the novels The Last Ballad, This Dark Road to Mercy, and A Land More Kind Than Home. He lives with his wife and daughters in North Carolina.